to introduce the first speaker of the session, Professor Esteban Vieda, with the paper Le debemos un galo a Asclepio, el carácter político de la muerte de Sócrates en el Fedón. A short introduction. Professor, it's in Portuguese. Oh, no, sorry, it's in Spanish. Professor de Filosofía, licenciado en Filosofía, Universidad de Barcelona, y doctor en Filosofía, también a Universidad de Barcelona.
Buenos Aires.
Buenos Aires, sorry, sorry.
I like Barcelona.
Okay, me too. Sorry. I didn't realize that it was written in Spanish. Foi becario de la Universidad de Buenos Aires, del Concert Tipo 1, beca doctorial Tipo 2, beca postdoctorial 2012-2013. Desde 2013 es investigador asistente del CONCET en la Universidad de Buenos Aires, jefe de trabajos prácticos de historia de la filosofía antigua, profesor adjunto de griego filosófico y ayudante de primera de lengua y cultura griega clásica. En la UCES, Universidad, es profesor titular de griego 1 y griego 2. Publicó los libros Aristóteles y la Tragedia, Platón, Apología de Sócrates, Critón. Y Epicuro, estudio preliminar, traducción y notas. So please, sorry.
No, it's perfectly fine.
Okay.
Thank you very much for the introduction. Shall I use this one? Or? No.
Hola.
Hola. Okay.
Well, thank you again for the introduction. Thank you to the University of Barcelona for the future works there. I will read in Spanish. Antes que nada, quiero hacer una pequeña aclaración, en realidad, que me honró cuando llegué al simposio y que al mismo tiempo me generó horror. Me honró que me encontré en el libro de resúmenes con los trabajos de las conferencias inaugurales o de la primera sesión plenaria que desconocía, de Beatriz Bossi y de Annie Larrivé, porque son temas bastante similares a lo que yo voy a decir ahora. Eso me honró en el sentido de que, bueno, alguien más eligió este asunto, y es exactamente eso mismo lo que me produjo horror, porque al leer los trabajos, evidentemente han abordado la manera de una manera mucho más extensa que lo que van a escuchar aquí. Así que mi reconocimiento a esas conferencias iniciales. Bueno, el título es Le debemos un gallo a Asclepio, el carácter político de la muerte de Sócrates en el Fedón. Voy a empezar haciendo algunas precisiones que aparecen más bien en Apología y Critón, considerando que ese final del Fedón, como algunos pasajes del principio, forman parte de la narración más bien de índole dramática de los acontecimientos que involucran a los últimos días de Sócrates. Por eso me tomo esa libertad. Mucho se ha escrito acerca del posible significado de las últimas palabras de Sócrates en el Fedón. Una de las razones de esa multiplicidad de interpretaciones radica en la tragedia y por eso mismo riqueza que todo grupo de últimas palabras tiene. Resulta imposible preguntarle a quien las dijo qué quiso decir. En este trabajo me propongo retomar el enigma de la deuda con Asclepio a fin de rescatar cierto matiz político presente en el parlamento final de Sócrates. Para eso me voy a detener en la concepción socrática del nacimiento y de la vida en tanto fenómenos eminentemente políticos, para, a partir de ahí, repensar el estatus de su muerte en esa misma clave. Finalmente voy a tratar de relacionar todo esto con la referencia al dios Asclepio en las últimas palabras del Fedón. Con respecto al nacimiento y la vida, las concepciones socráticas, en el final del Critón, ustedes recordarán que las leyes de Atenas dicen, cito, «No te dimos nosotras la existencia, y por medio de nosotras tu padre tomó el matrimonio a tu madre y te engendró a ti. Puesto que naciste, fuiste criado y educado, egenu, te cae exetrafes, cae epaideutes, gracias a nosotras. ¿Podrías decir que no eres ante todo descendiente y esclavo nuestro?» Critón 50D, 50E. Sin leyes que regularan su nacimiento o le permitieran rendir la docimasía, el examen de ciudadanía, Sócrates no hubiese sido un ateniense. Cosa que es prácticamente como decir que no hubiese sido un hombre. Así como el nacimiento no es un fenómeno biológico, sino político, lo mismo ocurre con la vida. Vuelvo a citar el Critón. No se debe tener mayor estima por el vivir, to zen, que por el vivir bien, to eu zen, 48b. El adverbio eu se explica de inmediato en el texto como sinónimo de bella o noblemente, kalos, y con justicia, dikaios. De modo que la vida propiamente humana es aquella que se ordena a lo justo y noble. La ley y la justicia están, pues, por delante de la vida biológica. Para que el hombre permanezca hombre, es más importante obedecer la ley, vivir una vida moral y justa, que seguir vivo en términos fisiológicos. Esta distinción entre zen y eu-zen concuerda con el carácter fundamentalmente político de la misión socrática en Atenas. Como se detalla en Apología 28a y siguientes, Sócrates decidió dedicar su vida a interrogar a sus conciudadanos, exhortándolos a filosofar, pero no para que especularan sobre la naturaleza en general, como bien aclara, sino para que se preocuparan por la virtud, la verdad y el alma, dejando de lado los negocios y las riquezas. La ética socrática se resume en esa famosa frase de la Apología 38a: la vida sin investigación no es biotos, no es vivible, no es digna de ser vivida para un hombre. Todo hombre debe vivir su vida autoinvestigándose con vistas a desterrar el error y, abrazando la verdad, poder obrar de manera virtuosa en la ciudad. De modo que el adjetivo biotos aquí no es de carácter biológico, sino moral. Retoma la tríada bien, noble, bellamente, con justicia, de la que hablaba hace un momento. La vida solo es vivible, por lo tanto, en el marco de la polis. Y es el diálogo cooperativo entre ciudadanos lo que conduce, eventualmente a la felicidad general. Me permito citar una vez más Apología 30D. Por lo tanto, señores atenienses, estoy ahora lejos de hacer mi defensa en nombre de mí mismo, como alguien podría creer. Más bien, la hago en nombre de ustedes. No sea cosa que, tras votar en mi contra, se equivoquen en relación con la donación que les ha hecho el dios. Hasta ahí la cita de Apología 30D. Para explicar esta misión filosófico-política, Sócrates apela, como se sabe, a una analogía militar. Al igual que un general en la batalla, el dios Apolo determinó su taxis, su puesto, en la organización de la ciudad. Taxis que, al igual que en una batalla, no apunta al bien particular de cada soldado, sino al éxito del conjunto. Como voy a tratar de mostrar en el apartado siguiente, Asclepio, el hijo de Apolo, opera según Platón de la misma manera, administrando la salud con vistas a que cada ciudadano pueda cumplir su rol en la ciudad, no a que cada ciudadano sane personal o privadamente. Ahora bien, si el nacimiento y la vida son fenómenos fundamentalmente políticos más que fisiológicos, algo similar cabría esperar acerca de la muerte. Cito una vez más Apología y ya paso al Fedón. Apología 28b y siguientes. Quizás alguien podría preguntar, ¿no te avergüenzas entonces, Sócrates, de haber realizado una actividad tal por la cual es posible que ahora mueras? Pero yo le respondería con un argumento justo. No hablas correctamente, amigo, si crees necesario que un hombre que cuenta con cierto mérito, mediano o pequeño, calcule el riesgo de vivir o de morir y no que solo deba examinar toda vez que actúe si acaso realiza cosas justas o injustas propias de un hombre bueno o malo. Hasta ahí la cita, sabemos que aquí Sócrates menciona a Aquiles, ¿no? A propósito de su decisión de ir a Troya, aún con la advertencia de Tetis. Bueno, y acá el punto, porque el simposio sobre el Fedón, ¿no? ¿Qué rastros hay de todo esto en el Fedón? ante todo, moralizar la muerte, politizarla, desbiologizarla, supone la incursión de lo humano en ella, lo humano en el sentido en que hablaba antes, ¿no? A propósito de ese eu. Y para Sócrates lo humano es sinónimo de decidir. Así como Aquiles es citado a propósito de su decisión de ir a Troya, incluso a sabiendas de que iba a morir ahí, Sócrates también opta por tomar la cicuta antes que realizar la acción inmoral de escapar. En el corazón argumental del Fedón, discutiendo acerca de la naturaleza de las causas, Sócrates hace referencia a esta decisión, cito Fedón 98e. Mientras que a los atenienses les pareció que era mejor votar en mi contra, por eso también a mí, a mi vez, me ha parecido mejor quedarme sentado aquí y más justo soportar la condena que ellos me impusieron permaneciendo en este lugar. Hasta ahí la cita. El objetivo de la decisión socrática no es la autoconservación biológica, sino la justicia, la autoconservación moral. Al igual que Aquiles, Sócrates podría haber optado por huir si hubiese antepuesto la vida biológica a la moral. No hacerlo trae como consecuencia la opción por la muerte, pero una opción especial, ni remotamente parecida al suicidio en el modo tradicional de entenderlo, pues en su caso se elige la muerte, pero positivamente. Con esto me refiero a lo siguiente: Sócrates no busca no vivir, sino morir bien, como corolario necesario de una vida bien vivida. Optando por la muerte en pos de conservar la virtud y evitar la vergüenza, Sócrates se hace digno de su propia muerte, lo que en nuestra época llamamos eutanasia. Este tópico ya había sido abordado en el Fedón. En 61d y siguientes, Sócrates afirma que el filósofo debe ser, cito, digno de cierta clase de muerte, axios hoiu thanatu. La muerte es cualificada con ese hoios. Y al menos una de las cualidades se relaciona con la dignidad moral, axios, de quien está a punto de morir. Sin embargo, en este punto ocurre algo que podría atentar contra esta línea de lectura que estoy proponiendo. La decisión de morir no está en nuestras manos, dice Platón, sino que depende del Dios que cuida de nosotros sus posesiones. Como dijimos en Apología 28d y siguiente, Sócrates explica a los jueces que el Dios le ha asignado una taxis, un puesto específico en la ciudad, mismo puesto que en Critón 51b afirma que le han asignado las leyes. Al igual que en la guerra, no hay que abandonar la posición por ninguna razón hasta que el general así lo disponga. Esta taxis está directamente relacionada con una función a desempeñar, en el caso de Sócrates, como ya dije antes, la misión de filosofar y mejorar moralmente a sus conciudadanos. En el Fedón, bueno, acá me meto a una pequeña concesión léxica, en realidad, porque sé que es una palabra discutida y que, salvo Rowe y Vigo, quizás esto no es tan aceptado, pero en el Fedón este puesto puede ser insinuado mediante el sustantivo frura en 62b4, tradicionalmente traducido por prisión, cárcel, etc. Pero en Leyes y en el Critias, Platón le da ese uso, ya sé que son diálogos lejanos al Fedón. Este sustantivo poco usual, frura, en el corpus, no necesariamente remite a una prisión, sino también a un puesto de vigilancia del que no es lícito desertar, y en el que quien fue asignado a ocuparlo cumple una función determinada. Solo el Dios puede determinar el abandono de la frura. Abandono que solo se dará cuando el filósofo sea moralmente digno de abandonarla. Ahora bien, ¿cuándo una muerte es digna? Y más todavía, ¿qué tiene que ver el dios Asclepio con todo esto? Paso al punto 3. Que, recordando lo que dije cuando empecé la conferencia, a propósito de Beatriz y de Anila Ribe, ya saben por dónde viene el asunto. Si bien el culto oficial a Asclepio no se vinculaba con la curación de enfermedades psíquicas, sino físicas, en el corpus platónico sabemos que en República tiene un estatus especial. República 3, 405d y siguiente, considera a Asclepio politikon. En el Laques hay también una referencia similar, es decir, una divinidad preocupada por la salud del colectivo de los ciudadanos antes que por la de cada individuo en particular. Esto explica que el Dios no cure cuerpos completamente enfermos, repito, con tratamientos extendidos en el tiempo, que encuentran en los fármacos un medio para hacer la vida macronca y cacón, larga y miserable. Asclepio no cura a quien no es capaz de vivir conforme los periodos establecidos de tiempo, porque eso no le sirve ni a él mismo ni a la ciudad. La inutilidad política del enfermo crónico se debe a la función de la que hablaba más temprano. Cada individuo tiene asignada una función. Si es un enfermo crónico, no la puede desempeñar. Función que en caso de tener que someterse a estos tratamientos no podría cumplir. Ahí está ese pasaje violentísimo, 407a. Si no cumple su función, no es conveniente que viva directamente. De estas premisas resulta la posición eutanásica de Asclepio, que, atento a los intereses del todo, sabe cuándo es políticamente beneficioso eliminar alguna de las partes. El puesto del que se hablaba en Apología y Critón se asimila en República con la función política de cada ciudadano, con su ergon. El criterio seguido por Asclepio para curar es político. La vida y la muerte dependen de la utilidad política de cada individuo. Volviendo al caso de Sócrates, si fue un Asclepio como el descrito en República quien le permitió vivir dignamente, es decir, cumpliendo con su función política en la ciudad, podría ser ese mismo Asclepio quien Efedón le permite ser axios hoi thanatu, digno de cierta clase de muerte. Desde un punto de vista fisiológico, esta muerte consiste en la suspensión de las funciones vitales debido a la cicuta. Desde un punto de vista moral y humano, eso ocurre producto de la condena por parte del pueblo ateniense. A los 70 años de edad, la utilidad política de Sócrates ya no es vivir, sino morir condenado por cumplir con su misión, pues su muerte oficiará como catalizador de quienes continuarán su gesta filosófica, entre ellos el propio Platón, que está escribiendo el diálogo. En Fedón 84e y siguientes, encontramos la famosa comparación entre Sócrates y los cisnes. Leo: según parece, ustedes creen que, en relación con la adivinación, soy peor que los cisnes que, cuando perciben que deben morir, habiendo cantado también en momentos anteriores de su vida, en ese momento cantan más y de modo más bello, contentos porque habrán de ir junto al dios del que son servidores. Los cisnes, aves de Apolo, padre de Asclepio, tienen un poder mántico como el que Sócrates se arroga para sí mismo. Mántica que, ustedes recordarán en Apología 39cd, Sócrates mismo se arroga a propósito del momento antes de morir. Bueno, voy a hacerles una profecía, le dice a sus jueces. Cuando yo muera, producto de esta condena, van a venir muchos como yo y los van a seguir interrogando, les van a seguir haciendo preguntas. Es decir, hace lo que hace el cisne. Canta su último canto profético. Salteo la cita de Apología. Con su muerte, Sócrates consuma su misión política inaugurando el socratismo como movimiento que irá más allá de su vida biológica, socratismo que hoy por hoy sabemos bien que no se agota en el propio Platón, ¿no? Los socráticos, así mal llamados menores, forman parte de ese espacio. Voy a la conclusión directamente. En Fedón 115b1, a pocos minutos del final, tiene lugar el siguiente diálogo. Critón hace su famosa pregunta: ¿qué nos encomiendas a mí o a los aquí presentes acerca de tus hijos o de algún otro asunto para gratificarte? Y Sócrates dice: lo que justamente siempre digo, Critón, nada nuevo, que cuidando de ustedes mismos, humonauton epimelúmenon, me gratificarán a mí, a los míos y a ustedes mismos. Pero si se descuidaran a ustedes mismos, ean de humonauton amelete, y no quisieran vivir en conformidad con las cosas que hemos estado diciendo ahora y en el pasado, como si se tratara de una senda, entonces tampoco, incluso si ahora mismo prometieran fuertemente muchas cosas, lograrían algo grande. Hasta ahí la cita Fedón 115b. Se trata, como se ve, de seguir la senda, la huella, catigne es la expresión en griego, inaugurada por el maestro, senda que consiste ante todo en el cuidado de sí y de ese modo en el cuidado del prójimo. Leo entonces las últimas palabras de Sócrates nuevamente. Critón, que creo que Beatriz, yo leí tu conferencia, ella hacía algo que las traducciones al castellano en general no vienen haciendo, que esos últimos verbos los traducen en singular, ¿no? Es rarísimo. Vigo mismo, Eggers antes que él, Gredos. Critón, le debemos un gallo a Asclepio. Pues bien, páguenselo y no se descuiden. Este carácter intersubjetivo que la misión socrática adquiere con la muerte del maestro se ve reflejado en la primera persona del plural que refiere a la deuda. Debemos, todos nosotros. El momento de retribuir esa deuda, sin embargo, de estar a la altura de la herencia recibida, ya no incluye a Sócrates, que estará muerto, sino a sus discípulos. La segunda persona del plural, en modo imperativo, da cuenta de esta orden: apódote, páguenselo, en modo imperativo. Sin embargo, y con esto termino, la palabra fundamental, la que condensa la totalidad de la vida filosófica socrática, es la que, según Platón, fue pronunciada última entre las últimas. manteniendo persona y número, segunda del plural, cambia el modo. Ya no se trata de la orden fría del modo imperativo, sino de la exhortación característica del subjuntivo. Un Sócrates moribundo exhorta a sus discípulos a que no sean descuidados, no descuiden en general, ¿no?, las cosas y a ellos mismos. Si la filosofía socrática tuvo como objetivo central persuadir a los ciudadanos atenienses de que cuidaran su alma antes que su cuerpo, el famoso epimeleistai, su exhortación final retoma esta idea. Tal exhortación no se refiere, pues, simplemente a la deuda con Asclepio, sino a la totalidad de la vida de sus discípulos frente a la misión que tienen por delante luego de su muerte. Gracias.
Muchas gracias, porque me ha gustado muchísimo la forma que relacionas todos los aspectos de, y también porque al final uno trabaja solo, ¿no?, en su escritorio, y entonces de pronto va a un sitio y otro que está también solo en otra parte del mundo está recogiendo también los mismos pasajes y dándole un significado muy parecido, aunque yo no me refería al gritón, pero tengo presente esto de detrás, ¿no? Y particularmente interesante me parece esta relación al pasaje de los cisnes que no tuve en cuenta, porque otros pasajes que tú mencionas también los mencioné, pero este de los cisnes no. Entonces te quería preguntar si tienes alguna idea de por qué Sócrates dice que ustedes creen que en relación con la adivinación soy peor que los cisnes, ¿no? ¿Por qué crees esto del peor? Porque es evidente que pienso que Platón está sugiriendo que esta obra que él está escribiendo es su mejor canto, quizás, hasta ese momento, ¿no? Después siguió escribiendo, pero Platón mismo dice, este es mi homenaje a mi maestro y este es el mejor canto, entonces pongo a ponerlo con esta metáfora tan bonita. Pero no entiendo lo del peor. ¿Tienes alguna idea? Gracias.
Sí, gracias a vos. En su contexto, es una pregunta retórica, ¿no? Es una pregunta retórica con algún dejo de ironía.
No, la mía es auténtica.
No, la de Sócrates.
Ah, Sócrates.
¿Cómo te voy a decir eso? No, la de Sócrates, digo, es una pregunta retórica. Evidentemente no es eso lo que los alumnos están diciendo, lo que los discípulos, perdón, están diciendo. Es el lugar que él quiere poner en el otro para después correrse. Famosa pregunta con leve dejo de ironía. Pero además en ese contexto no hay que perder de vista lo que está ocurriendo dramáticamente. Ya se ha ido este hombre que trajo la cicuta, Sócrates dijo, Josasteios, Joántropo, ¿no? Este hombre es más civilizado que todos ustedes que han estudiado la filosofía. Entonces ustedes no están entendiendo nada, ustedes creen que yo soy peor que los cisnes de Apolo, porque en este último canto mío están viendo un mensaje triste, malo, peyorativo, y en realidad soy como los cisnes, estoy cantando mi mejor canto, que es el último que se canta antes de morir, ¿no? Entonces creo que va por ese lado. En el contexto es más clara la ironía o el carácter retórico, diría, más que irónico.
Tiene esto de contentos, sí. No sé cuál es la palabra que te creo, pero es muy importante porque eso destruye la interpretación tradicional de que Sócrates está contento de morirse.
No, claro.
Está contento de cantar, de haber vivido la vida que vivió, sino de morir, ¿no?
Eso. Gracias.
Muchas gracias, a mí también me ha gustado mucho su relación. Tenemos una pregunta sobre el contexto histórico o el contexto político, el contexto de lo sagrado en la vida. La muerte de Sócrates devorado por la fiesta de Apolo.
Sí.
Y Sócrates reconoce que su condena fue injusta, que es justo y que sí, los atenienses van a ejecutarlo, pero todavía acepta la condena y pues ¿Qué piensa usted en, en esta situación muy ambigua? La relación entre Sócrates y su ciudad que justamente le ha condenado, pero a, que, a la cual todavía tiene una lealtad.
Sí, sí, entendí, creo que entendí. Si no te entendí, me decís. Gracias por la pregunta. Lamentablemente tengo que referir al pasaje del Critón, ese pasaje famoso en el que, en el diálogo con la prosopopeya con las leyes, viste que las leyes le dicen, bueno, y si algo malo ha ocurrido en todo este proceso judicial, los culpables son los dicastai, son los jueces y no nosotras. Es decir, a mí me costaría creer que Sócrates piensa que ha fallado el sistema político. Me parece que en todo caso han fallado los jueces, ¿no? Desde mi humildísimo punto de vista, el universo, digamos, lo que Sócrates contempla como universalidad en términos morales es la polis, ¿no? No es Platón en ese punto. Entonces ese es su techo metafísico, es político su techo metafísico. De manera que ahí yo creo que no hay falla. No quiero ser anacrónico diciendo que el problema de Sócrates no es con la institución, sino con los funcionarios, porque armar un Estado acá siempre es problemático, pero remitiría ese pasaje del Critón, ¿no? Donde la distinción es clara. Una cosa son los nomoi y otra cosa son los dicastai, que son humanos, en definitiva. Me parece.
Entiendo más o menos una pregunta. ¿Usted piensa que hay una distinción importante entre lo político y lo biológico?
Sí. ¿Sí?
Mi pregunta es que son las dos cosas, ¿sí? Lo biológico y por otra parte lo político.
Político.
Sí. ¿Son totalmente diferentes o incluye posiblemente lo político un aspecto biológico?
Bueno, ahí es donde me parece interesante esa concepción platónica de la medicina en República, ¿no? Donde la salud biológica, claro, carnes, exactamente, deben estar al servicio de la política, que como decía antes de una manera muy torpe, es el telos aquí, ¿no? En un sentido, también es causa, casi me atrevería a decir como causa final, ¿no? Como la instancia de realización humana. De manera que más que distinción a secas, quizás me atrevería a pensar en cierta forma de subordinación. Subordinación implica una relación, la subordinación, no una distinción tajante, implica una relación, pero donde la utilidad pública debe primar siempre por sobre el interés privado, y el interés privado es siempre curarse, y Sócrates da cuenta de eso, no se fuga en el Critón, toma la cicuta voluntariamente, da cuenta de eso. No, la polis viene antes que lo que a mí, y es lo que Critón no entiende en el Critón, ¿no? Pero me parece buena tu observación para, más que hablar de distinción, quizás hablar de subordinación. Sí, gracias.
No question anymore.
A mí me parece que esto que has dicho de la dureza de la muerte del que no sirve, que no cumple su función, ¿no?, en la ciudad. O sea, que todo está siempre antes que la parte, esto es Platón, Aristóteles, los griegos, vamos. Ahora, que la única cosa que se me ocurre para, y que lo moral esté por encima de lo físico, como bien has dicho, también está claro que es así. Pero quizás, en el caso de Platón, la única cosa que podríamos, desde nuestro punto de vista, hacerlo un poco menos cruel, ¿no? Porque esto parece muy espartano, verdaderamente muy poco ateniense, ¿no? Es pensar que para Platón la muerte, puesto que no es más que un paso, ¿no?, daría quizá ocasión a que esta persona que tiene el alma corrupta pueda empezar de nuevo, ¿no? ¿Cómo aparece en el mito? Quiere decir que para nosotros la muerte es, tiene un significado final, quizá, pero para él no. Entonces es quizá la única manera de que para Platón la muerte no es más que un paso y puede ser la liberación de un alma, no sé, corrupta o de un cuerpo corrupto a empezar de nuevo, ¿no? Pero bueno, no sé qué piensas de eso.
Sí, rapidísimo respondo. Sí, a mí me parece que se puede explicar eso sin necesidad de recurrir a la vida post-mortem, sin necesidad de recurrir a la inmortalidad del alma, ¿no? Por eso traté de situarme en Sócrates, un intríngulis imposible, ¿no? De Sócrates, Platón. Pero en la lectura que traté de hacer, traté de prescindir de eso, porque creo que la misión socrática se consuma sin necesidad de aquello otro, ¿no? ¿Viste los artículos de Clarks, de Krug, algunos que dicen que el propio Platón se ausenta para ponerse él como heredero, por ejemplo? Como, más allá digo, pero viste que más allá de que no estemos de acuerdo, yo creo que no es necesario. Es súper interesante incluirlo y creo que se articula tal como vos lo decís, pero también se puede hacer sin ese argumento, ¿no? También se puede hacer, me parece interesante pensarlo sin recurrir a eso, que obviamente encaja perfecto. Así que gracias por el comentario.
Muchas gracias, Professor Esteban. Now I introduce Professor Edrizi Fernandes. His paper is, the title is Es bien morir e il Fedón en la España quinientista. Now a short introduction. Edrizi Fernandes is licentiate in philosophy by the Universidade Federal do Rio Grande do Norte. He's got his master's degree and also his PhD at the same university, Universidade Federal do Rio Grande do Norte, and he is also a physician, a medical doctor. And not with less importance, a collaborator professor and research attached to the post-graduation program in philosophy at the Universidade Federal do Rio Grande do Norte and to the UNESCO Archive Cathedra of Western Thought. Okay, thank you. Please.
Bueno, muchas gracias. Mi presentación será una especie de digest del trabajo que está en los anales. El bien morir consiste en dejar la existencia corporal sin turbación o temor, con la certeza de inmortalidad del alma y de los galardones futuros para los virtuosos y buenos. Para Platón, en el Fedón 67d, los que filosofan en el recto sentido de la palabra se ejercitan en morir y son los hombres a los que resulta menos temeroso de estar muertos. En la glosa de Díaz de Toledo, a los filósofos no les desplace de morir ni los dan por difícil y grave cosa. Sin embargo, para los no filósofos, la muerte se mantuvo una seria preocupación. La enseñanza platónica sobre la muerte ganó relieve para el bien morir de los hablantes del castellano después de las traducciones de Pedro Díaz de Toledo, de las cuales trataremos aquí. Conforme Adolfo Bonilla y San Martín, la primera versión castellana que conocemos de algunos diálogos de Platón se debe al doctor Pedro Díaz de Toledo del Consejo del Rey Don Juan II. Marcelino Menéndez y Pelayo habló el siguiente sobre Díaz de Toledo. El primer escritor español de quien positivamente consta haber traducido, aunque no directamente, alguno de los diálogos platónicos es el castellano Pedro Díaz de Toledo, colaborador que fue del marqués de Santillana en sus nobles empresas de erudición y de cultura. Son curiosos estos primeros ensayos del humanismo español, todavía no seguro de sus fuerzas. Antes de 1445, tenía romanzado el doctor Pedro Díaz, valiéndose de la versión latina, entonces recentísima, de Leonardo Bruni de Arezzo, el libro de Platón llamado Fedrón y No contento con haberle traducido, le invitó un año después en su diálogo o razonamiento sobre la muerte del Marqués de Santillana. Díaz de Toledo tradujo entre 1442 y 46 los proverbios del pseudo Séneca por encargo del rey Juan II y encomienda del Marqués de Santillana, que le solicitó la redacción o traducción de textos para la educación del príncipe Enrique, el futuro Enrique IV, que no sabía latín. Entre sus traducciones de manuscritos venidos de Italia, sitúase aquella del pseudo platónico Axíoco, dedicada al marqués y quizá el primer diálogo filosófico en una lengua romance. El más importante hecho literario de Díaz de Toledo es sin duda su traducción del diálogo Fedón de Platón, que tiene el título de El libro de Platón llamado Fedrón, a partir de la traducción latina de Leonardo Bruni, el Aretino, del que hay edición y estudio modernos. Por algún motivo extraño, que puede en verdad deberse al hecho de que en latín Fedos se traduce por repulsivo, cuando se copió el texto de la traducción de Bruni en 1416 en Inglaterra, se le dio el título de Fedrón, que ya era el nombre que llevaba la vieja versión latina de Aristipo. Es normal pensar que pronto llegara a Inglaterra. Díaz de Toledo se empeñó en traducir al castellano la enseñanza de los diálogos platónicos, no solamente por su contenido, pero también por su forma de exposición que permite al autor en sus propias palabras explicar mejor y más cumplidamente su intención. Platón fue conocido en la Castilla premoderna, sobre todo a través de los escritos neoplatonistas, como el Liber de Pomo, diálogo entre Aristóteles poco antes de morir, y algunos de sus discípulos que le piden consejo sobre cómo evitar el temor y la perturbación ante la muerte. Obra inspirada en el Fedón y atribuida a Aristóteles, fue traducida al latín hacia 1250. Para Jaume Riera y Sanz, podemos asegurar, sin cegar el riesgo de equivocarnos, que todos los maestres en artes y en teología del siglos XIV y XV habían llegado el Liber de Pomo. El Liber de Pomo pone en la boca del Gestagirita algunas de las ideas cristianizadas de su maestro. De esta forma, constituyó uno de los principales vehículos de difusión de las enseñanzas de Platón sobre la buena muerte. Entre ellas están las nociones ya introducidas en el Corpus Christiani por los padres de la Iglesia, del cuerpo como una cárcel que impide alcanzar los grados superiores del conocimiento, y de la liberación del alma a través de la muerte, a la cual no hay que temer, sino que recibirla con serenidad y alegría. Para Díaz de Toledo, Platón podría ser presentado como el filósofo el cual, más que otro filósofo alguno, afirmó el ánima ser inmortal y las ánimas de los buenos y virtuosos haber galardón del otro mundo y las ánimas de los malos haber pena. Un hombre filósofo sin fe, solamente atraído por la razón y el hombre natural. Platón no hubiera sido entonces el filósofo pagano que más se había acercado de las verdades de la Sagrada Escritura y del cristianismo, en particular en su representación de la vida contemplativa del más allá. Un mundo mejor, donde hay placer sin medida, folganza sin ansia y sin trabajo, como dice Díaz de Toledo en sus glosas a los proverbios de Séneca. Pero el intelecto y la iluminación natural no son para Díaz de Toledo superiores a la revelación y la fe. En su traducción del Axíoco, mientras utiliza el epíteto de divino hombre para Platón, parece relacionar esto más directamente a su anticipación de la enseñanza cristiana que a cualquiera cualidades intrínsecas. De hecho, el traductor castellano del Fedón escribe que los que allén de la razón del hombre natural son informados de la ley que Dios dio y publicó, son obligados a creer, más que Platón y sus seguidores, en la inmortalidad del alma y las recompensas post-mortem para los buenos. Díaz de Toledo explica las razones de su traducción del Fedón en la introducción, donde aparecen alusiones directas y ausentes de la traducción de Bruni a aquellos que niegan la inmortalidad del alma, comenzando por los epicúreos y los saduceos. Nuestro autor toma por evidente el verdadero principio de que del mundo hubo comienzo y habrá fin, y cree que Dios ha de traer a todo hombre a juicio por las cosas que fará, lo cual no podría ser si el ánima no fuese inmortal. Niega de esta manera los argumentos de dos sectas contra las cuales Aristóteles advierte en el Liber de Pomo. La opinión de la primera secta incluye la doctrina de la eternidad del mundo y la creencia en que el mundo no tiene sustentatorem ni gobernatorem. Esta creencia fue particularmente identificada en el pasado con los epicúreos. Con la segunda secta, aquella de los yontistas, que dicun quod anima simul sit creata con corpore vel de corpore, Díaz de Toledo concorda en parte, comentando el Fedón 72de. Según desuso es dicho, nuestra ánima es creada al tiempo que el cuerpo es organizado, y nunca fue primero. Y esta es la opinión de Aristóteles y lo que nuestra fe cree. Sin embargo, pero Díaz no puede aceptar que el alma muere con el cuerpo y concorda con Platón que las ánimas de los muertos son y están. Pero no concorda con la tesis platónica de la rememoración y si el alma es creada al tiempo que el cuerpo es organizado, nuestro aprender más se dirá nuevo saber que rememorar. Las reflexiones en torno a la vida y la muerte fueron materias de mucha reflexión por Díaz de Toledo. Ya en su versión del Apsíoco recuerda que, según dice Aristóteles en el tercer libro de sus Éticas, lo postrímero de las cosas temerosas y espantables es la muerte, y esto con gran razón. Que por aquella fallecemos y dejamos de ser, y como el principal deseo de los animales sea conservar su ser, dudan y recelan la muerte así como cosa contraria y destruidora de su ser. Ya sea que por necesidad de la natura de la muerte, de natura de la muerte no se puede excusar y el temor suyo congoje y trabaje las voluntades de los hombres, empero el gran filósofo Platón, príncipe y caudillo de la compañía académica, porque con reposado y folgado corazón pudiésemos vivir, habló en esto así como en todas las obras cosas divinalmente, introduciendo a Sócrates, que disputa y hace persuasiones y razones, por donde entiende probar que la muerte no solamente no se debe temer, mas antes debe se desear, porque casi por divinal sentido arraiga de nosotros el miedo de la muerte y el temor de aquella parte de nuestras voluntades. Para González, Roland, Saquero, Suárez, Somonte, la idea central aquí planteada es que la muerte es la cosa que más asusta, espanta y hace dudar al hombre porque su mayor deseo es conservar su ser. Y por eso es natural preguntar qué razón bastaba atraer a los hombres a se disponer a morir, siendo aquella, la muerte, lo postrimero de las cosas temerosas y espantables. Las voluntades de los hombres que necesitan ser trabajadas frente a la inescapabilidad de la muerte son de cierto aquellas descritas por Gutiérrez Díaz de Gámez en el Victorial o Crónica de Don Pedro Niño. Dice Platón que no andemos siempre con nuestra voluntad, mas contra nuestra voluntad. Que el que anda contra su voluntad, este es el segundo andar, que es bueno. Y este es de natura del alma que manda el cuerpo con los otros sentidos. Entonces, el cuerpo es tenido y regido y enderezado por el alma, y férmese con ayunos y oraciones y castidad y con buenas costumbres. Y que si el cuerpo es dejado y dado a su voluntad, dase a corrupciones y luxurias y avaricias y a soberbias y a otros pecados que son de natura de la tierra, que gobierna el cuerpo con los otros elementos. Donde dice el mismo Platón, mientras eres joven, por seso múdate, alímpiate y dispón toda verdad. Deja toda falsa cosa que es de natura de la tierra. Abstente y dispón y usa toda verdad. Deja toda falsa cosa, todo pecado. En el primer capítulo del diálogo y razonamiento en la muerte del marqués de Santillana, Díaz de Toledo plantea el problema esencial de la obra, la relación entre alma y el cuerpo. El marqués dice: se me representa delante el terror de la muerte que turba mi entendimiento. Represéntame que muriendo seré privado de esta luz, de los bienes de este mundo, de la vista y participación de tan gloriosa prosapia, y compañía de fijos y nietos, y ya seré en el que el sepulcro, deforme y sin sentido, convertido con diversos animales, que así lo dijo el profeta Isaías. Tu cuerpo se desfará, y pullilla lo comerá, y tu vestidura será gusanos. No creo que juzgaré sin razón, que a cuestas y semejantes razones me deban mover y conturbar, aunque quiero que creades que cuanta posibilidad basta, yo me esfuerzo a pagar esta deuda de natura, mas yo ruego que por aliviación de esta agonía y trabajo, en que esto me digades las razones que vos ocurrirán para satisfacer a las cosas dichas que me conturban y a otras semejantes. El doctor contesta diciendo: por satisfacer vuestro mandato introduciré algunas persuasiones y razones filosóficas que no discrepen de la verdad de nuestra Santa Fe Católica. Pasado de esta presente vida perderéis todo sentido corporal y no seréis vos mismo aquel cerca del cual acaecen las cosas dichas. Debemos considerar que desatado el cuerpo mortal, el alma se va a dar cuenta aquel a quien la crió y recibirá galardón o pena según que acá obró. Y el cuerpo que sin ánima queda, que no siente, ni se puede ni debe llamar hombre, según dijo un filósofo, no somos ánima inmortal, detenida en cárcel mortal, que la natura nos vistió de este cuerpo para padecer dolores y trabajos, mezclados con los deleites corporales que no son estables, más perecederos. Y las enfermedades de ese cuerpo derramada, y ansias y tristeza comúnmente nos acompañan, por la cual causa el alma por todo el cuerpo derramada, sintiendo las grandes aficiones del cuerpo, desea su celestial morada, e ir a aquel que la crió y redimió. El filósofo que dijo que el hombre es alma inmortal detenida en cárcel mortal, es sabidamente Platón, así traducido por Díaz de Toledo en el Fedón 82e. Las ánimas están ligadas y atadas en tanto que están con los cuerpos como mediante cárcel. La turbación no debe afligir a aquel que conozca las rectas persuasiones y razones filosóficas, pues nuestra alma, que de todo, es inmortal, no perece cuando se desata del cuerpo. Y si el cuerpo no siente, ni se puede, ni se debe llamarse hombre sin el alma, así ocurre porque las almas corporificadas están en gran ignorancia. Cuando Díaz de Toledo tiene por cierto que el alma, según obró en vida, con la muerte va a recibir de aquel quien la crió galardón o pena, también sigue a Platón. Y en el capítulo 5 del diálogo y razonamiento, que trata entero del suicidio, el marqués quiere saber si se ocurre que por la muerte el hombre pasa de mal a bien, por cuál razón los virtuosos no se matan para se libertar de las penas de esta vida. Dice el marqués: si es verdad que pasar de esta vida mortal a la vida inmortal es pasar de mal a bien, de miseria y trabajo a folganza y reposo, ¿por cuál causa los virtuosos y discretos no se trabajan y procuran de salir de esta vida mezquina y ser trasladados en vida inmortal? Y si bien me acuerda, paréceme que leí de uno que se llamó Teobroto, que después de haber leído el libro de Platón de la inmortalidad del alma, con gran corazón se dejó despeñar del muro por salir de la miseria de esta vida y ser trasladado en vida mejor. Así mismo sabéis que Séneca, en una de sus epístolas a Lucilio, escribe que el gran Catón, la noche antes que muriese, después de haber leído el dicho libro, y conocida la disputación que Platón hace en el de la inmortal del alma, se metió un cuchillo por el cuerpo y así murió. En una glosa a su introducción al Fedón, la información de Díaz de Toledo sobre Catón son más completas. Según dice Séneca, en la epístola a Lucilio, Catón, la noche antes de que muriese, puso su espada a la cabecera y se puso a leer a este libro llamado Fedrón, las cuales dos cosas quiso hacer en los postrimeros días suyos. La una, que es leer del libro porque se supiese que quería morir. La otra, que es poner el cuchillo a la cabecera porque se supiese que podía morir. El otro día siguiente dice que se metió el cuchillo por el cuerpo diciendo: oh fortuna, no has hecho cosa en embarcar a mi propósito, que si yo he peleado hasta aquí, no he peleado por mi libertad, sino por la libertad de la patria. Ni me he habido en esta guerra así porfioso, tanto por ser libre como por vivir entre libres. O cuán bien murió Catón, dice el marqués en su obra Proverbios o Sentiloquio. Díaz de Toledo no concorda con esa lectura. Al prólogo de su traducción de la Epístola a los Jóvenes, leemos: ¿qué seguridad puede tener el que cree ser bienaventurado si es vera o falsa o purificta la gloria que posee y cómo en cuánto grado la debe recibir y tratar? Y aún entre las desesperadas adversidades colocanla, ¿cuál gloria ninguna prosperidad no podría dar? ¿A qué mejor cosa pudo alcanzar Catón que el cuchillo con que se mató? En el diálogo y razonamiento, Díaz de Toledo dice que Catón se mató con poco corazón y no con virtud. Querer morir no es problemático. Platón cree que el problema está en matarse cuando no hay compulsión por causas inevitables. Él sugiere que el suicidio es justificable cuando Dios ponga alguna necesidad para ello. Entre las necesidades perdidas no pone la defensa del honor, aunque en España, al menos desde la época de Alfonso el Sabio, con su exagerada consideración de la fama como estructura mental nobiliaria, el suicidio empezó a ser una práctica común. En la discusión sobre el suicidio en el diálogo y razonamiento, Díaz de Toledo contesta utilizando argumentos cristianos de Basilio y Agustín, por ejemplo, la interpretación estoica o senequiana de este tema del Fedón, obra en la cual Platón condena el suicidio. Díaz de Toledo también contesta en la misma ocasión la defensa estoica de la muerte voluntaria hecha por Vías en el Vías contra Fortuna del Marqués de Santillana. Para concluir, en el diálogo y razonamiento, Díaz de Toledo reescribe las opiniones del Marqués e indirectamente también de Platón para presentarlas como más compatibles con las creencias cristianas y neutralizar la obra de Santillana con su justificación del suicidio, con su indiferencia hacia el infierno, con su predicar una separación entre alma y cuerpo, es decir, con una serie de principios y preceptos estoicos que no figuraban en las versiones corrientes del estoicismo. La ficción poética distinguía entre el autor Díaz, así que Pero Díaz podía atacar la tesis del filósofo antiguo sin ofender la memoria y el renombre del Marqués. Sin embargo, la ficción poética es una cosa y la realidad práctica es otra, y un autor anónimo escribió en una carta enviada al arzobispo de Toledo en 1462. Oh míseros tristes que estabades en Platón, vosotros metisteis entre la gente grande turbación, grande movimiento y fabulaciones. El editor de la carta anónima escribe: aventuro la hipótesis de un juicio depreciativo hacia el filósofo como dardo que apunta a las actividades de algunos hombres incorporados al grupo de Carillo, Verbe y Gracia Díaz de Toledo. ¿Cuáles serían entonces las razones de un juicio depreciativo hacia Platón? Conforme Vilacañas Berlanga, Platón incluía indeseables aspectos construidos alrededor de la transmigración de las almas, así como la más que dudosa tesis de la existencia del alma con anterioridad del nacimiento del ser humano. No obstante, la opinión general de Díaz de Toledo en relación a Platón es favorable, y para eso cuentan seguramente las opiniones, pero no las motivaciones de Platón a favor de la inmortalidad del alma y contra el suicidio. Además, el pagano Platón no estaba totalmente engañado en sus creencias sobre la relación del alma con el cuerpo, la inmortalidad y la providencia divina. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias. Obrigada, Edrizi. Ok. Questions?
May I ask you, in English, two questions? What was the first translation of Plato's Phaedo into Spanish? Was it by Pero Díaz de Toledo?
Yes.
And the second, thank you. Yes. Second question, it's more a question of curiosity. We have the theory of of resurrection, which has been dogmatized by the 5th century after Christ by a Council of Toledo, and we have the theory of reincarnation by Plato. Is there any influence of Plato's theory of reincarnation on the theory of resurrection?
Well, I may answer from the point of Díaz de Toledo. He doesn't accept either of the two theories. So for him, it's not a matter of discussing this, because he's a priest, and so he follows the doctrine of the church. And furthermore, he is a descendant of a Jewish family. So when he wants to make something different from the Christian version, the Christian beliefs, sometimes he reports to Maimonides. He translated also Maimonides' More Nebuchim, the Guide of the Perplexed, into Spanish. So he doesn't discuss this question directly using Platonic sources.
Any other questions? Okay, so let me introduce. Thank you, Edrizi. Let me introduce now the third speaker, Professor Yasuhira Kanayama. And his paper is Socrates' Last Words. A short introduction. Yasuhira Kanayama is a professor of philosophy in the Department of Philosophy, Nagoya University, Japan. His main interest lies in Plato's epistemology and methodology, and also in ancient skepticism. He's the author of numerous articles in Greek philosophy, especially on Plato, including papers to the Phaedrus, the methodology of the Second Voyage, and the proof of the soul's indestructibility with Plato's Phaedrus, and a translator of Greek philosophical works, such as All the Topics, Sextus Empiricus, that's right, sorry. And together with Mariko Kanayama. And also another work with many other authors, The Modes of Skepticism and Ancient World Modern Reflections, with a few other translators. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm very honored. And there are some additions there, you can see. So I'll start. One question of interpretations. Already called Camilleri's for the abdomen, when Socrates uncovered himself and said, the last word he uttered, Crito he spoke, before Proctor Scribius, please you, Imperator, don't fail to take care. What did Socrates mean by these enigmatic words? To help solve this problem, we can ask the following questions. A. Are Socrates' last words his real words or Plato's invention? B. The offering to Asclepius one of gratitude or of petition. C. Why did Socrates ask Crito after drinking hemlock? D. Could Crito understand the sudden request by Socrates? E. Why did Socrates ask Crito and another? F. Why did he ask for the offering not to Apollo, whose servant he was throughout his life, but to Asclepius? G. Why was it our debt, including Crito? H. Why did Socrates ask for the offering by you, in plural? Question B can be very easily answered. O in we all suggests gratitude. As the object of gratitude, we can think of the following possibilities. 1. Something enigmatic reflecting Socrates' ironic character. B. Healing of his friend from mythology. 3. Healing of Socrates himself from this life seen as a disease. 4. His success in giving birth to his own death, which is regarded as childbirth rather than a cure. 5. His success in completing his life soundly in body and in soul. 6. Calm and peaceful death he is just experiencing. 7. Encouragement for philosophical mission continually given to him in dreams. 8. Healing of Athens from the plague. 9. Healing of the ills of Athens by the voluntary death of Socrates. 10. Some concrete healing of somebody to do with Socrates. 10a, Socrates himself. 10b, someone from his family. 10c, Plato. 2. Historicity. I adopt 10c. However, in spite of Phaedo's remark, Plato, I think, was ill, some interpreters take the illness to be Plato's invention, claiming, one, that because his presence as a witness might restrict his literary freedom, he created a world where he was absent from the prison. Or two, that Plato feigned illness because he was too much disturbed by his master's unjust death to be present in the prison. However, first, against claim two, when someone we love is going to die, it is a matter of most vital concern to us to stay nearby. Plato himself tried to be of support to Socrates' standing surety for the fine of 30 minas. Did he change his mind after the trial? Why are there no names of Plato's brothers among the people who were present at Socrates' death, which took place about 1 month later after the trial?
where Adeimantos was present. The most likely reason that they were together with Plato, who was in danger of his life and unable to be near Socrates. What about claim one? Let us see here the overall structure of the Phaedo in the form of ring composition. A, dialogue between Echecrates and Phaedo. B, Phaedo's description of what happened in the morning. C, Phaedo's narration, which consists of philosophical arguments. B dash, Phaedo's description of what happened in the evening. A dash, Phaedo's final remark to Echecrates. There will be nothing wrong about A, C, and A dash being fictional. For those who are still alive around the publication of the Phaedo could have easily identified them as such without finding anything wrong about the inclusion there of Plato's philosophical creation. However, the inclusion of falsities in B and B dash is different. B is introduced after Echecrates thrice requests Phaedo to describe as accurately as possible both what was said and done and who are present. Three is a special number for Plato, as is represented in the proverbial expression, the third cup to the savior, i.e. Zeus, which with a request repeated three times being hard to resist. Plato employs thrice repetition also when reporting Socrates' last words, repeating the verbs of saying three times. He said epen, he uttered epitexato, he spoke epe. Phaedo's description of what took place in the prison both in the morning and in the evening, as well as Socrates' last words, must be historically true. Three, Crito's understanding of Socrates' last words. However, there are still some interpreters who want to relax the historicity. G.W. Most adopts Tensi, but still admits the possibility of the last words being Plato's invention. He starts from the assumption that even if the last words had been Socrates' actual words, his intention would be unrecoverable. On the further supposition that only Plato's intention can be recovered, he concentrates on what Socrates' last words might have meant to Plato, not to Socrates, or rather on what Plato might have intended them to mean to us. He sees thus in the last word the intention of reading Plato as Socrates' philosophical heir. However, let us note that Crito's reply, "But that indeed shall be done," begins with Allah in Greek, which expresses, according to Denniston, practical consent, expression of willingness to act in a required way, sometimes with a nuance that the speaker not only agrees, but repudiates the very idea that dissent is possible. Crito, who is so punctilious, shows no sign of puzzlement, listening to Socrates' request and addition, but rather indicates that Socrates did not have to express it, and continues without faltering, "But see whether you have anything else to say," which I think reflects his confidence that he is certainly able to perform Socrates' request. Four, Plato's return from Hades. Because of a short time allowed here, I cannot deal with each of the interpretations mentioned above, but I want to point out that when we admit that the last words are Socrates' own, and that they were words of gratitude, there is no interpretation so far presented that can satisfactorily be explained all of the conditions C to H. I choose 10C, healing of Plato. Phaedo's remark that Plato, I think, was ill supports this interpretation. But so far, almost nobody except Most has strongly argued for this interpretation. It is because if Plato was still ill, this interpretation does not agree with B, offering of gratitude. And if Plato had recovered, we cannot help wondering, first, how Socrates could know it, and second, why Plato did not come himself to convey the news of his healing. In order to secure the news channel about Plato's recovery, Most resorted to Socrates' prophetic clairvoyance as a servant to Apollo, but Socrates' prophecy concerning his felicity in the Phaedo and bad Athenian's misery in the Apology, which comes from his philosophical consideration, is definitely different from the magical power that allows one to predict someone's recovery from a disease. Besides, the recourse to prophecy does not go along with Crito's understanding. However, this does not mean that we should give up 10C. If it is a complete healing, it is something in the future. But as we saw above, the absence of Plato and his brothers suggests that he was so seriously ill as to be on the verge of death. Then even the news of his escaping death would be a thing to be thankful for. Asclepius was the god who could save people from death. Socrates must have heard this good news at some time before drinking hemlock. But when and from whom did Socrates hear the news? There are two possibilities. P1, in the morning from Crito. P2, after bathing from Xantippe, who returned home and came back again. P2 is more likely, for if he had heard it in the morning, others too would have heard it, with Plato's illness thus having become a matter of common knowledge. Then Phaedo would have said to Echecrates, Plato was ill, without inserting, I think. Plato, I think, was ill, he was his comment. The fact that there's no report of Plato's illness except in the Phaedo also suggests that only a limited number of people had definite information about his illness. If we adopt P2, on the other hand, we can then easily explain why the time of Socrates' request to Crito was between the bathing and death, and why Crito didn't feel any difficulty in grasping what Socrates meant. Socrates was talking with Xantippe in Crito's hearing. But why did Socrates not ask Crito immediately after hearing the news from Xantippe? For one thing, he has told many things to her concerning his family affairs. He may also have been so overwhelmed with joy by the news that he's not hit upon the idea of a thanks offering. But after drinking hemlock, the idea of the offering occurred to him. How? After Socrates drank hemlock, Crito got up and went away, being unable to restrain his tears. Then Apollodorus, who had been weeping all the time, wailed aloud in his grief. They were the only people whose names are mentioned in Plato's description of Socrates dying. At the beginning of the dialogue, Phaedo named people who were in the prison, dividing them into several groups. The first group consisted of three people, Apollodorus, Critobulus, and his father, i.e. Crito. If we leave aside Critobulus, who diligently follows his father, we find then that this first group appears again at the end of the Phaedo. However, one person is missing. It is Plato. For, Socrates said in the apology, Plato here, and Crito, and Critobulus, and Apollodorus tell me to propose a fine of 30 minas. Before Socrates bathed, Crito asked Socrates how to bury him, and Socrates in his reply refers to Crito's previous pledge to the jury. Whatever this pledge may be, the recall of Crito's pledge is supposed to have made Socrates think about Plato, who was the initiator of the pledge at the court. Then Crito went out and Apollodorus wailed. Their sorrow naturally leads Socrates to Plato's sorrow, and then to his illness, and to the worry Socrates shared with his close friends, and finally to his delight in the news of Plato's escape from death, and their shared gratitude. Thus we, who owe the collective debt, are this group who prayed to Asclepius for Plato's recovery, and you, who are asked to offer the sacrifice, are the members of this group minus Socrates and Plato. And it was because Crito was the oldest and was near to him that Socrates asked Crito. The most important message Plato received from the last words was that Socrates thought about him at the last moment of his life. 5. Socrates as psychagogic Heracles. The Phaedo is characterized by ring composition, or rather by what may be called return composition. And the motif of returning, as is indicated by the overall plan of the Phaedo shown above, as A, B, C, B dash, A dash. Plato himself, whose name appeared at the beginning, returns at the end in Socrates' mind. Although I don't enumerate here many returns appearing in the Phaedo because of the shortage of time, the number of returns I could count has amounted to 25, among which one of the most important returns is certainly Plato's return from his approach to Hades. Returns need the turning point, and the turning point in the Phaedo is its middle, where Phaedo's narration is broken by the resurfacing of the frame dialogue between Echecrates and Phaedo, occasioned by the depression into which Socrates' friends were thrown by the arguments of Simmias and Cebes. Here we meet a most impressive scene in the Phaedo, when Socrates encourages them. He plays with the hair on the back of Phaedo's neck, as was his habit of doing so, and compares himself and Phaedo to Iolaus and Heracles, although the truth was that Socrates was Heracles and Phaedo Iolaus. My hair, in Phaedo's remarks, suggests on the surface that Socrates liked to play with his hair, but it suggests also the hair of the author, Plato. Phaedo happened, etchon, to be sitting at Socrates' right hand on that day. The expression happened indicates that it is the usual seat of someone else, in all likelihood, Plato's. And there's some addition there. in enumerating the names of those present in the prison, how did Phaedo psychologically go out of his way to mention Plato, who was not present? I think that Phaedo made his search of memory starting from the seat of the emotional Apollodorus near Socrates, probably from left to right in Greek epidexia, and then returned to the bedside of Socrates, the seat of Plato, which made him utter Plato. But suddenly he noticed that Plato was not there that day, and this made him continue. I think he was ill, and they owe him my estimate. Return to the text. Heraclitus and Iolaus were the lover and the Paedica, and when the Paedica, Iolaus became old and was attacked by Eurystheus, he was given a new life of youth by Hebes at the request of Heraclitus, Ulysses Heraclitae, or Ovid Metamorphoses. The lover, Heraclitus, on the other hand, was capable of bringing back Alcestis from the dead, Ulysses Alcestis. The Greek word for bring back from the dead is Pshikago again, and Aristophanes, using the same word, describes Socrates as an unwashed person summoning up souls, Pshikago again, by a swamp of the shade foods and birds. Apart from its literal meaning of to lead the soul, the verb had a derogatory meaning of conjuring up the dead, and the Pshikagogos as a noun had that of necromancer. This is why when King Admetus saw Alcestis and thought that she might be a ghost, Heraclitus said that he was not the Pshikagogos taking offense to the king's response. However, their literal meaning is leading the soul, and Hermes is in this sense Pshikagogos, that god who has the office of leading departed souls to the nether world. In clear contrast to Aristophanes' description of Socrates as an unwashed person mocked as doing the work of Chicago again, Socrates in the Phaedo had a bath before dying from his loving care for Xantippe, and his Chicago again was a genuine leading of the souls of his friends. Phaedo said, Socrates healed us, called us back in flight at defeat, and turned us around to go forward. Just as Heraclitus as a Pshikagogos hero in its proper sense was able both to turn around Iolaus in flight under the threat of Eurystheus and to bring back Alcestis from the dead, so was Socrates as a Pshikagogos philosopher able to heal, hold back and turn his friends around when they were under the threat of the arguments of Simmias and Cebes. People designated here by us in Phaedo's remarks, Socrates healed us on the surface level, Phaedo and those present in the prison. But Plato, as the author, could include himself among us, suggesting that he himself was healed and called back by Socrates at that very same moment. The time when this midpoint event took place seems to have been intended to coincide with the time when the crisis of Plato's disease was passed. In fact, the arguments of Simmias and Cebes concerned the soul's destruction when the body, lyre, and the clothes was broken. Plato, whose body was in the danger of being broken, may have heard Socrates calling in his dream, which was then followed by his soul returning to the body, Plato belonging to this world again. Socrates' last words end with me amerezete, don't fail to take care. The verb here lacks the direct object, though usually accompanied by it in Plato, and it is possible to separate this request from the preceding request of thanks offering. Don't fail to take care represents for Plato both Socrates' gratitude Asclepius for Plato's recovery and address to his friends, including Plato not to stop the care, epimeleia, of the soul. 6. Plato's illness. When Socrates uttered his last words, not only Crito but also Phaedo and other friends must have heard them. From whom among them did Plato learn about Socrates' words? The fact that Plato's report of them in the Phaedo was followed by Crito's reply suggests that it was from Crito that Plato learned the exact phrasing of Socrates' request. As to Plato's escape from death, on the other hand, it was Crito alone that could guess that the last words might represent Socrates' gratitude for it, listening to Socrates' conversation with Xantippe. Phaedo's remark to Kecrates, Plato, I think, was even softened by, I think, suggests concerning the information sharing of Plato's illness, either one, that Crito tried to keep Plato's illness secret even to Phaedo, or two, if Phaedo was in such friendly terms with Plato as to be naturally informed of the latter's illness, that Plato depicted Phaedo as trying to prevent Kecrates from asking further for the exact information of Plato's illness. In either case, Plato's friends who were informed of his illness seemed to have tried to keep it secret. What was then the problem with Plato? the day for which the ship was sent to Delos, resulting in the postponement of Socrates' execution, was closely related with the plague that attacked Athens in 430 BCE and later again. One of its main symptoms was a high fever, which is the very feature that appears in the proof of the soul's immortality as a subtler cause for a person whom it occupies becoming ill. Plato's recovery without any further spread of the disease may suggest that it was not, after all, the plague. However, what mattered to the people concerned was not its identity, but the reaction of Athenians. In Sophocles' Proctetes, which was played in 409 BCE in the theater of Dionysus next to the Asclepieion, the illness of Philoctetes was attributed to divine punishment incurred by his approach to Chryses' servant. In Aristophanes' Heroes, which remain only in fragments, the chorus of Heroes, which must have included Heracles, sang, "We are dispensers of evil and good. We watch out for the unjust, and then and send them diseases, spleen, coughs, fever." Phreton. And there's the last addition. Fever in the Phaedo was the bearer of illness, and could have been regarded by Athenians as sent by God with death as its ally. It was natural for Plato's family and friends to keep Plato's feverish disease secret, not only when Plato was ill, but also even after he recovered, especially because Plato's suffering took place when the city must be kept unpolluted after the ship had been sent from the area. If people knew about it, they might connect it with Plato's attempt to help Socrates and suspect religious pollution and divine punishment. 7. Plato's secret. It was about 15 years later that Plato made public the fact of his illness and the exact phrasing of Socrates' last words in the Phaedo. But why did he suddenly decide to do so? In Königsberg's From the Mixed Up Files of Mrs. Basil E. Frankweiler, Claudia Kincaid, aged 12, wondered why Mrs. Frankweiler sold a marble statue made by Michelangelo, Angel, which had been kept at her home for a long time and now is in the Metropolitan Museum of Art, only for $225. Her answer is because after a time having a secret and nobody knowing you have a secret is no fun. And although you don't want others to know what the secret is, you want them to at least know you have one. Socrates' last words were angel for Plato. To leave them buried was no fun, but neither did he want others easily to know what they meant to him. In the prison, Socrates first composed a hymn to Apollo, and then after that he turned the myth of Aesop into verse. Aesop is said to have been killed by the Delphians. Socrates was killed by the Athenians. Gaining inspiration from Aesop, Socrates made poems, which appears at the beginning of the Phaedo, and gaining inspiration from Socrates, Plato completed the Phaedo, which naturally comes at the dialogue's end. Here again we can observe one of the many returns in the Phaedo. But what Plato turned into a hymn to Apollo was not a literary work, but the essence of Socrates' words and deeds. This hymn to Apollo, the Phaedo, was for Plato the testimony of his final recovery from the disease, and as such, the thanks offering to Apollo's son Asclepius. But it was also the hymn to Socrates proclaiming that his death was not meaningless on the basis of the theory of forms, which gives meaning to Socrates' life of inquiry, and also on the proof of the soul's immortality, which gives meaning to his death remotely caused by his mission of inquiry enjoined by Apollo. It was also the thanks offering to Socrates, who left this world on the very day of Plato's return to this world, as if giving his physical life to, and continued to work as Heracles, even after death, giving a spiritual life to Plato, as I will all else, in their profound relationship of love. It is natural then for Plato to keep making Socrates the protagonist in his dialogues, for his philosophical journey is the journey of Aeolus, encouraged by Socrates' last words, and accompanied and led by Socrates' giving as Heracles inside Plato himself. This, I think, is the very secret Plato hid in Socrates' last words, his angel revealed after about 15 years later in the Phaedo.
Thank you, Professor Kanayama. Now, questions?
So, it's ingenious, part of what you're doing, but I'm wondering why much emphasis in the Phaedo on a transformation of values, a transformation from what ordinary people think is valuable to what's really valuable and what really matters. And so on your reading, the last lines, we'd be going back to a very conventional sense of what the gods are doing. And it looks like, in particular, the idea that avoiding death is a good thing, that we should be happy that Plato has avoided death, when the whole focus of the dialogue has been on we shouldn't be fearing death so much. So wouldn't it be much more natural to think that whatever we thank the gods for would be something like a removal of ignorance, or in fact bringing us death, or, you know, there's a variety of other things that have been emphasized as goods that we would want to thank the gods for, but avoiding death seems like about the last one.
In the Apology, Socrates says something like that, we are not oak or... and it's that one, it refers to the meeting of Odysseus and Penelope, and Odysseus tries to hide his tears. And I think Socrates is also a human being, and we are all human beings, and we and so, but at the same time, if death is comes upon us as a necessity, Socrates is very open to accept it. And so, and the most important thing, anyway, for Plato was that Socrates thought about him. He loved Plato. And I think I can sense that very much. And that gave Plato the drive to follow Socrates. Incompatibility at all, because anyway, so after Socrates, to compose the Phaedo, he took 15 years, and so those 15 years, his philosophical thought is sort of put into this dialogue.
Thank you for the talk. I enjoyed it a lot, but also related to the first questioner, I have some disbeliefs that I wanted to ask you about it that you could address. One is that before he says the final words, there's something that you didn't mention, is that he's covered himself, and then he uncovers himself. Besides the fact that this is kind of comical, you know, or what's going on, why is Socrates sort of uncovering himself? And do you think that there's something going on there? Also, your reading puts a lot of emphasis on trusting Crito. And if there's a portrait that's drawn of Crito in the Phaedo, it's that he doesn't get it. He doesn't get the idea of very important about the soul. And you quote the last part of Crito's question, but see whether you have anything else to say. And Socrates doesn't have anything to say, but his body moves. So it's as if Socrates' body is sending a message, but it's that the body doesn't say anything. It's the soul that needs to say something.
Philosophically, Crito doesn't understand so much. But as a friend, he understands very much. And when Socrates went to have a bath, Crito followed. I think it was just to wash Socrates, to help Socrates to wash himself. Socrates covered himself with a cloth, and you cannot know exactly what Socrates was thinking, but according to my story, he could hear he could guess, and he could think about his friends. And one of them is, of course, Plato.
Thank you. I agree with an awful lot of what you say, and I think it's... I agree with you that the references to Plato's recovery recovery. And I think you brilliantly improved on most interpretation by pointing out that there's a perfectly mundane way that Socrates could know about Plato's recovery without any need for clairvoyance. But what I'm most bothered about is, unless I've misunderstood you, you think all of this is historically true. There really were Socrates' last words, and Plato really had recovered his health on that day. If so, a fantastic bit of luck for Plato, because it really means that Socrates, as he died, really was thinking of Plato. And then I think whether we go with you and just say Plato was pleased that Socrates thought he was thinking of him, or we go with most and say Socrates was glad that Plato would live on to develop his philosophy and be his natural successor. Which of those we think is going to be entirely our own judgment, because since this is historical fact anyway, there's going to be no way that Plato could Plato's own view about what it meant plays any part in the account. Is that right?
Suppose the person whom I love died, then what I'm going to do is perhaps try to write down what he or she said on the last day, and I want truth about words and deeds of that person, and not fiction. But I don't want want others to know too much about what is left, what is behind those words and deeds. And so perhaps my interpretation is very much influenced by my own way of thinking. But I...
Yes.
One more question.
Hi, a very rich reading. And I had a question about your account of the motivation behind the I think. Plato, I think, was ill. You suggest that it's a matter of keeping a secret. And I'm wondering if you have any sort of independent textual evidence for that reading, as opposed just to thinking that maybe time has passed and they don't remember.
My textual evidence, if you say so, that's all. Anyway, I tried to draw as much textual evidence, but what I can definitely say is that my interpretation can answer to all the questions and conditions, and other answers, no other answers can't. So I think that's the most crucial point for my interpretation. Of course, interesting thing is that, for example, for the relationship between Socrates and Xanthippe, etc., your way of living is reflecting in interpretations.
Yes.
Thank you very much, Professor. Now our fourth speaker is Professor Panagiotis Thanassas, and his paper is, its title is What Kind of Death? On Phaedo's Double Topic. A short introduction of the professor. He studied law in Athens and philosophy in Tübingen, where he received his PhD with a dissertation on Parmenides. He's associate professor at the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, having also taught at the universities of Tübingen, Heidelberg, and Cyprus. During the summer semester 2015, he was visiting professor at the Ludwig Maximilians University Munich, Antique Philosophy. He is a fellow of the Alexander von Humboldt Foundation and has also received fellowships from the Evangelisch Studienwerk Philips, from DAD and from DFG. His research interests focus on the pre-Socratics, Plato, German idealism, Heidegger, and hermeneutics. He is author of the books Hegel, Reason and History, Introduction to the Philosophy of History. And the other one, Parmenides, Cosmos on and Being, a Philosophical Interpretation. Okay, Professor, please.
So, thank you. I would like to thank all of you for being here at this late time of this conference. There is a further introduction now by me. As you have probably noticed, I speak with both a heavy Greek and a heavy German accent. So you cannot follow my talk without having the text in front of you. Today has been uploaded a version of my text with highlighted parts that I'm going to read. So those of you who can now fast download this version are asked to do it. For the others, I've made some hard copies. And I would like somebody to help with distributing them, but please give priority to those who cannot download the version from the page with the separate full papers. So, what? I didn't expect so many here, so I just made 20 copies. Should I start? Yes. What kind of death on Phaedo's double topic? According to a widespread conviction, any understanding of a Platonic dialogue must start by identifying the real subject or the primary aim around which the dialogue unfolds. For the Phaedo, this question seems to have a clear answer. The dialogue subject is death, and its basic aim is to prove soul's immortality. More specifically, and in view of his own approach in demise, Socrates attempts to show in a series of arguments that the philosopher should not fear death, for it actually constitutes a relief from the sufferings of earthly life, a release from bodily shackles, and an event that does not affect or endanger the immortality of the soul. And if this is the case, then a characteristic pursuit of philosophers could be not only to study death, but also to desire it. This communist opinion arises not only as a result of an interpretative assessment of the dialogue, it is directly presented within the dialogue itself. In 64 AB, a Socratic reference to the relation between philosophers and death incurs the laughter of Simmias, who remembers and cites the view that philosophers, quote, are indeed verging on death, and this is what philosophers deserve to undergo. But whose point of view is this? It is, of course, the view of the many, which could also be accepted, the view which also be accepted by many compatriots of Simmias, i.e. inhabitants of Thebes, a city known for the influence exerted by Pythagoreanism. This widespread perception of hoi polloi, though, which coincides with the most common interpretative approach to the dialogue, is explicitly criticized by Socrates, who finds fault with its lack of conceptual clarity and awareness. The many, says Socrates, fail to understand in what sense real philosophers are verging on death, in what sense they are deserving of it, and what kind of death they deserve. The double emphatic he and the additional hoio jointly indicate here that death is a polachos legomenon in Phaedo, not a unique concept, but a word that calls for further investigation, analysis, and conceptual distinction. The lack of interest manifested by the vast majority of commentators for this Socratic statement is therefore, to my eyes, surprising. In the present paper, I will investigate various occurrences of the word death and its cognates throughout the dialogue, in order to demonstrate that the arguments and the overall approach of Socrates depend upon a double meaning of death as termination of life, which I will call DA, or as philosophical vocation D1 and D2, of course. Two notions of death. The distinction between two different notions of death has already been made earlier in the dialogue. The first relevant passage is the brief but significant conversation brought on by the reference to Evenus. Requested to dispel the expected concerns of Evenus in view of his own recent engagement with poetry and music, Socrates justifies this engagement in a playful way and concludes with an ambiguous message to Evenus. So give Evenus this message, Cebes. Give him my greetings and tell him, if he's sensible, to come after me as quickly as he can. This reference is perceived by Socrates' interlocutors as an invitation for Evenus to follow Socrates in physical death. And this assessment inspires the ensuing discussion on suicide. This perception, however, does not prevent Socrates from interjecting a highly interesting remark. Commenting on the certainty with which Cebes rules out the possibility of Evenus following him in death, Socrates retorts, "Why? Isn't Evenus a philosopher?" To follow Socrates in death means here to follow him in the practice of philosophy. Socrates thus reveals another meaning of death, death as philosophy, offering to the perceptive reader the possibility of distinguishing two concepts of death. His interlocutors understand death in the ordinary sense, i.e. only as physical death. This is what I call D1. Death is the termination of earthly life. But Socrates undertakes a conceptual shift which actually prefigures a new concept, D2, death, is the in-life emancipation from the bonds of body or of sensibility as intended and practiced by the philosopher. The first indication of the necessity of this distinction is provided already in the immediately following fully justified question raised by Cebes. How can you say this, Socrates? How can it be forbidden to do violence to oneself and at the same time be the case that the philosopher is willing to follow the dying? Cebes notes here an obvious contradiction that arises for the philosopher. He cannot but wish for the occurrence of death, but at the same time he is not allowed to cause it himself. The contradiction is resolved if we realize that the prohibition of exercising violence on ourselves refers to bringing about physical death, D1, and as such is forbidden. The invitation to follow Socrates in his release exhorts us to follow him in death as D2, i.e. in philosophy. But Socrates avoids making this clarification. At this point of the dialogue, he completely bypasses the newly implicitly introduced notion of D2 and returns to the first superficial interpretation of his message to Evenus, trying to explain why that invitation did not involve an incitement to suicide. This move links him back to the unequivocal understanding of death shared by his interlocutors. His reservations against suicide are based on the impiety of such an act and are not really justified philosophically. We encounter here for the first time something that will be observed several times in the course of the dialogue. When Socrates is asked to talk about death as disease, D1, he is unable to offer arguments with conclusive philosophical validity. In any case, his first allusion in 61c to a different meaning of death is a distant hint, which attempts to prepare the perceptive reader for the distinction implied in 64b. The first explicit reference to the notion of D2 is to be found in 64a. Quote, "Other people may well be unaware that what those currently engaged in philosophy pursue is nothing other than dying and being dead. Simmias, however, is not able to grasp this notion. In his intervention, he hastens to identify the Socratic apothneskain dekai tethnarai as a thanatosi. Simmias now, quote, philosophers are indeed virgin of death, and this is what philosophers deserve to undergo. While, therefore, for Socrates, dying as D2 is a constant enterprise within life, for Simmias, death as D1 diminishes to a momentary passing which terminates life. Simmias proves thus unable to follow the Socratic conceptual openness and is rather eager to cancel it. He revokes death's polysemy and brings the conversation back to his preferred ambiguity, in which he even equates the Socratic understanding with the vulgar perception of the philosopher's relation to death. Faced with this withdrawal, Socrates contents himself with pointing out in 64b that there is more than one notion of death, and he only stresses the need to raise the question which forms the starting point of this paper: in what sense and what kind of death? This Socratic question is an attempt at defending the distinction against the common understanding, which remains blind towards it and unwilling to accept any notion of death other than D1. A preliminary clarification of the two concepts of death might prove useful at this point. Death as D2, i.e. as philosophy, denotes the search for truth through logoi, through valid arguments, and not through myths and comforting or exhortations. The content of D2 becomes apparent later when Socrates, in his so-called autobiography, develops the hypothesis of forms. Dealing with D1, on the contrary, reflects an existential anxiety, which, as I believe, cannot be tackled philosophically. Philosophy is not expected to remove existential burdens. The genuine philosophers. There is, however, a passage in the dialogue which seems to undermine all claims that have been made by me up to this point. It is the passage 66b to 67b in which Socrates delivers a series of views whose adoption is seen as necessary for all genuine philosophers. He says, "For all these reasons, then, some such view as this must present itself to genuine philosophers, so that they say things to one another such as these." And then he opens up a long quotation. "There is no other passage, I think, in the Platonic corpus presenting philosophy as a form of thanatophily and urging philosophers to ardently desire their death. At the same time, the genuine philosophers substantiate here all those prejudices of the many, which Socrates indirectly but clearly pointed out when he stressed their naivety and inability to understand in what sense philosophers are linked to death and refer to it. Or, in other words, the opinions of the genuine philosophers clearly cancel the distinction introduced by Socrates in 64b. It seems to me, therefore, that in the passage on the genuine philosophers, Socrates does nothing more than what he says. He presents a series of foreign beliefs, doxae, without explicitly or implicitly stating that he adopts them." Misology. As we all know, the dialogue proceeds with a Socratic exposition of 3+1 arguments for the immortality of the soul. This is an attempt to comfort his interlocutors about his imminent demise. This lengthy focus of the conversation on death as passing away, D1, which continues with the objections raised by Simmias, soulless harmony, and Cebes, soul as a weaver, is interrupted for the first time in the digression on mythology. This is not meant to be a charming or superfluous break. The digression is located exactly in the middle of the dialogue and makes up its epicenter. The digression is marked by the fact that Echecrates speaks here for the first time after the initial framing of the dialogue. This shift from the narrated dialogue taking place in prison to the framed dialogue also denotes a transition in the content. What in a superficial reading might appear as a break is in fact a Socratic detachment from the expectations and fixations of his interlocutors on D1 and the thematic shift of the debate from D1 to D2, from physical death to philosophy. Socrates here avails himself of the chance to deviate for a moment from the issue of the risks arising from human mortality and to discuss the greatest risk for philosophy itself, which he identifies as a hatred for logoi, as mythology. The significance of the passage is underlined by the fact that it is the only extensive part of the dialogue where the main interlocutor of Socrates is the person who gave his name to the dialogue, namely Phaedo. And this might also explain, in my view, why the dialogue is named Phaedo. The shift begins with an affectionate Socratic gesture narrated by Phaedo to Echecrates, 89 BC, we all know the passage, which provides the most explicit contrast of Socrates' interests with those of his interlocutors. The latter worry about death in the sense of their D1. They seek proofs of immortality or they lament the death of their friend. Socrates, on the contrary, is primarily interested in logos and in philosophy, concerned only about their own endangerment. While his interlocutors are preparing themselves to mourn his death on the following day, he invites them to give priority to another probable mourning, the mourning for a possible failure of logos, for this would be the greatest evil. The full and clear priority given by Socrates to the topic of philosophical inquiry over the consolation for death expected by his interlocutors is explicitly formulated later when he asks them, quote, to concern themselves less with Socrates and much more with the truth. This same Socratic preference will also force him to completely abandon for a while the expectations of his partners in order to offer a comprehensive report of the Platonic philosophy of forms as it will appear in the Socratic autobiography. This autobiography presents the hypothesis of forms as the culmination of a historical development and thus undertakes a first attempt at demonstrating the historicity of philosophy. I will not analyze here this passage, of course, but turn instead to the last words of Socrates, his famous utterance in which he invites Criton and the others to settle a common debt and offer Asclepius a rooster owed to him. The cock and the cure. The debt to Asclepius can only be the result of a cure, or perhaps more broadly, of successful prophylactic treatment against a possible severe disease. But which disease was prevented? What kind of healing occurred? The text actually does include a simple but significant explicit reference to a cure. It is provided within the mythology digression when Phaedo notes in 88E, 89A, I will not read the passage here. Finally, just this sentence, finally, how well he cured us, says Phaedo to Echecrates. Indeed, the evidence of this passage in its association with a passage on mythology, to which it is obviously related, creates a complete picture of an illness cured, which is denoted by the last wish of Socrates. Phaedo describes here Socrates in the role of a doctor. And I skip the rest in order to come to the very last part of my talk. I will need another 3 minutes, probably double topic for a double audience. The topic of the dialogue is ultimately death in a twofold way, while the Platonic Socrates addresses a double audience. The first audience is intertextual and includes the interlocutors of the Socratic persona, Simmias and Cebes, Phaedo and Crito, the silent listeners of the last Socratic discussion, but also the lamented Xanthippe from 60A. A key feature of this audience is its thematic and existential focus on death as the one. In view of the approaching demise of their beloved friend, death as passing away becomes their sole concern, a source of anxiety, and the origin of every query and request addressed to Socrates. Convince us, they tell him, that your death as termination does not mean a complete annihilation. The second audience is that of the competent readers of the dialogue, which Plato addresses by posing the really crucial question. It is, how are we expected to practice philosophy? Or, in other words, what does it mean to verge on death in the sense of D2? The entire Phaedo is first and foremost a dramatically outstanding elaboration of the coupling of these two topics, intentions and audiences, in the intersection of which we can locate the Socratic persona. Socrates thus assumes a dual role. On the one hand, he meets the need of his friends for a blend of consolation and hope vis-a-vis death. On the other hand, however, he fulfills his own desire, which shortly before his own death still remains the same as throughout his entire life, the desire for philosophy. If, however, and this is the last passage I'm going to read, if, however, the dialogue proceeds on these two distinct levels, if it has two different concepts of death as its topics, and if it is addressed to two different audiences, why then Socrates does not explicitly distinguish between the two concepts? The answer can only be found in the dramaturgy of the dialogue. If Socrates had made the distinction, we would no longer have retained a contact ground with his interlocutors. He would. And Phaedo would not have been possible, or it would have taken a completely different form. It would be a different dialogue. This duality marks at the same time a continuous hermeneutic challenge for the reader, inviting her to examine the appropriateness and validity of the Socratic mythologay, both in its mythological and argumentative form, and to undertake the hermeneutic task of diagnosing the presence, extent, and significance of a different concept of death, D2. In other words, the philosophically experienced reader, with focus on the refuge to the logoi and the establishment of forms, while the anxious and scared child within us will take refuge in the proofs of immortality and the consolation they offer. Thank you very much. More than 22 minutes, I think. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Professor Manassas. So now
we are open
to the questions.
Well, thank you. The question you asked at the end, why didn't Socrates explicitly distinguish his two sentences on the word death? Well, as an alternative to your answer, I suggest because Plato never, anywhere in his corpus, distinguishes two sentences of a word, with one exception in Euthydemus, where he attributes it. He says it's the sort of thing Prodicus would say.
I didn't hear the last the reference.
There's a passage in the Euthydemus about the double meaning of man famine,
Okay.
Where Socrates does use it to solve a sophism, but he says it's the sort of solution that Prodicus would give you. In other words, it's really lexicographical. So I think that when we look for the distinction of meanings of words in the text of Plato, it's because we're imposing Aristotle.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
You said that the 66 feet to 67 feet was the only place where we got an idea that the philosopher is pursuing death in what you call the D1 sense.
No, I said it's the only place, as far as I know, where we have such a strong view of what I have called thanatophily, desire for death. Virginal death.
I don't know if it's such a strong, but in 80E to 81A, we come back to it after the affinity argument, and we're told that such a soul is doing nothing but to pursue philosophy correctly and practice to be ready for really being dead, or wouldn't you call this practice for death? So he comes back to that. So does a soul in this condition go off into what is similar to it, the unseen, the divine, the immortal, and wise? So it doesn't seem like it's just a sort of one-off at 67B. It seems like there's discussion of the philosopher is practicing for being in this disincarnate state, and that's connected to escaping the cycle of reincarnation there. So that seems like you can't just sort of set aside the 66 passage.
Yeah, I think there is a point there, and it has been made clear to me throughout this conference that this passage 81, 82, on which Professor Halper, I think, has put emphasis, is something I have to take into account much more than I have done up to now. Yes, thank you.
Can I speak German? For me,
as far as I'm concerned, yes. It would be much better for me.
Yes.
Also,
ich glaube, Ihre Argumentation ist sehr überzeugend. Und ich glaube, Sie kann noch von anderen Überlegungen gestützt werden, die mit dem Beginn des Dialogs zu tun haben. Und zwar all diese la insistencia, die insistence, jetzt fällt mir das deutsche Wort. All diese Anhäufung Referenzen zu Abstände, zu Distanzen am Anfang des Dialogs.
Zu abwesenden Personen, meinen Sie?
Nee, zwischen Athen und Phleius oder Athen Delos und so weiter. Müssen irgendeinen Sinn haben. Bei Platon ist nichts willkürlich. Ne? Und dann, der erste Gedanke ist, vielleicht ist der Abstand des Todes gemeint. Also der Abstand oder die Distanz, die von der Reise impliziert wird zwischen hier und dem Hades. Nicht? Aber das ist zu dumm. Das ist eine triviale Distanz. Das kann nicht, das wäre eine Distanz wie die anderen, wie die zwischen Athen und Phleius und so weiter. Aber wenn wir die ganze Reihe lesen im Zusammenhang, dann werden wir darauf hingewiesen oder auf die Passage hingewiesen, wo Sokrates vor uns zuerst antritt, und zwar als er die Shackles, als die, ich weiß nicht jetzt, der, das deutsche Wort, von ihrem Bein weg, also entfernt werden. Da tritt Sokrates als ein Theoros, als einer, der sich, der fähig ist, in einer ganz oppressiven Situation sich als einer zu benehmen, der von vornherher kommt, der als ein ja, Histor oder Theoros sich benimmt. Das wäre die, und das ist gerade die Philosophie, nicht? Also der Anfang des Dialogs ist, es ist, als ob der Anfang des Dialogs sagen würde, die wahre Distanz ist nicht der Tod, ist die Philosophie. Also der wahre Tod ist vielleicht die Philosophie, wie Sie sagen. Nicht?
Gut, ja, also vielen Dank für diese Anmerkung. Ich muss sagen, ich habe gewisse Vorbehalte in Bezug auf eine Art des Umgehens mit dem Text, die man im weitesten Sinne allegorisch nennen könnte. Ich glaube, das bringt einige Gefahren mit sich, aber das ist, ja, gut, aber das ist wirklich eine Stelle, auf die ich Bezug nehmen muss. Vielen Dank.
Thank you for your paper. I think I cannot agree with you with a statement on page 3 at the end of the page when you say philosophy denotes the search for truth through logos, valued arguments, and not through means and comforting or exhortations. And then philosophy is not expected to remove existential burden.
Yes, I mean, in principle, you are not wrong. This was just a sentence I have put in my text, which denotes a certain, yes, meaning by Deutsch, as Abstand,
a distance
from the Platonic text. But concerning Plato himself, now, it's enough for me if we can distinguish the two ways. And then the second question is, for Plato again, if the two ways have equal value, or if the one way, the second way, is a way to which we move if we have realized the Grenzen, the limits. So okay, just 5 minutes German and I forgot my English. The limits of the first way. So sorry.
Some extent, that kind of reading could be applied to other dialogues. For instance,
the notion of punishment in the Gorgia that has two levels, according to you. Now, but I wonder whether your reading does not have a high price. That is, I missed a few lines because you jumped and I didn't have the paper version. But if I may read a sentence, you say, the failure of Logos lies not in the inability to compose or to defend a specific argument or answer a specific theological question. Warning becomes Logos only when a deep and firm hatred has arisen for it. It seems then that the attachment to Logos would be a generic one.
Not an attachment to specific arguments or theoretical positions.
Yeah, but I see a difficulty in it because it seems to be, I'm not trying to be it.
Here is the unintended beyond word. It's a detached kind of logos because it's not incarnate in terms of a particular logos defending a particular view, in this case, the immortality of the soul. It would be a general attachment to Logos, but then unspecified. In general, it is not a problem to detach it from any specific point.
I don't know if you might ask for too much, for much more than what the texts can give us. May have. A similar question is, does Plato have a theory of forms or a hypothesis of forms? The old Gadamer always said we have just a hypothesis of forms, not a theory of forms. But this is another huge problem, of course, which only to some extent is related to what you're asking. What I read, at least in Phaedo, is that the major issue is to save ourselves from the greatest danger, which is this hatred for Logos altogether. And this is also why the hypothesis of forms has this very general, generic, if you want, function or meaning or relation. I don't see here specific theoretical, philosophical, dogmatic, if you want, positions that have to be saved, but just the very logos itself.
One more question, please.
Thank you. I have a problem with your reasoning rather than your position. Because even if we distinguish these two senses of death the way you do, you then assume, I thought without arguing, that they are quite separate. And I think that is not at all obvious. That needs arguing. For example, what would say, look, if the highest task is philosophy, and if philosophy for Plato depends on seeking for knowledge, not primarily or not even at all by relying on the senses, somebody could object, look, but we depend on our senses, we depend on our body. And so it would be very, very relevant to address the question, do we really depend on our body in the sense that is related to death one? So it's one thing to distinguish two senses. It's another thing to say these senses are quite unrelated.
Mm-hmm. Yes, you are right, of course. And this is, if I may refer to this, the part of my paper of which I have not read a single sentence. Its title is A Common Ground. It is a more broad notion of death. It is on page 4, etc. And there I speak of death, of a notion D of death, which is common to both D1 and D2. And this is what Socrates himself calls death, D in general, as the separation of the soul from the body, or a release and parting of soul from body. So there is this common ground which enables both sides, so to speak, to make up their own notion of death. But what I think is quite important for my intention, or what has been my intention in this paper, was to stress the tension between these two notions of death, D1 and D2.
Thank you.
defense, I may add a sentence, it's a work on, in progress. I'm very grateful for any remarks later or by email or so on. That's why you have my email address on this. So thank you very much.
Thank you.